हरे कृष्णा, वेलकम एवरीवन। लास्ट टाइम वी हैड स्टडीड दिस टू पावरफुल वर्सेस दैट ड्राइव अवे ऑल डिप्रेशन, लैमेंटेशन, कंफ्यूजन, स्पेशली आवर टेंडेंसीज टू एक्ट बेस्ड ऑन आवर लोअर नेचर। आई वुड लाइक यू टू रिमाइंड ऑफ देम। फर्स्ट वॉज कुतस्त्वा कश्मलमिदं विषमे समुपस्थितं अनार्यजुष्टम अस्वर्ग्यम अकीर्तिकरम अर्जुन। इंस्टेड ऑफ अर्जुन यू कैन पुट योर ओन नेम देयर। कृष्णा इज सेइंग, माय डियर बाल गोविंद, हाउ हैव दिस इम्प्यूरिटीज कम अपॉन यू? दे आर नॉट एट ऑल बिफिटिंग अ मैन हु नोज द वैल्यू ऑफ लाइफ। They lead not to higher planets, but to infamy. Klaibhyam asmagamah partha naitatvayupapadyate kshudram hrudaya daurbalyam tyaktvo tishtha parantapa. O son of Prutha, do not yield to this degrading importance. It does not become you. Give up such petty weakness of heart and arise, O chastiser of enemy. How many of you used to play some games like say basketball, football, volleyball? Okay. How many of you had official coach? You had taken training professional. Every game, generally, the coach gives a pep talk. You know, it is not just meant to cheer you up. It is actually meant to give you some orientation as to what should you focus on and what should you not do. So, till here, Lord Krishna is in that mood of a friendly pep talk. He has not assumed the role of guru for Arjuna. He is just giving a friendly pat on the back and said, come on man, don't give up. Just do your duty and you will be happy in life. And we can see, because Krishna is in friendly terms with Arjuna, Arjuna is not yet, he has not yet got over his confusion. That's why in this text 4, Arjuna is restating his earlier arguments. Why I don't want to fight? So we had studied his arguments. C, E, S, D and I. C for compassion on bodily platform. I want to be good and not harm others' bodies. So I don't want to fight. E for enjoyment. If I kill everybody, then what remains for me to enjoy? Who will I show off? E. S for sinful reactions. If I kill, killing is a ghastly activity, I'll get sin. So I don't want to fight. Then D for destruction of family traditions. Kulakshaya. I don't want to be the cause of that. And I is in this chapter indecision. I'm just plain confused. If I think from Nyaya Shastra point of view, Artha Shastra point of view, Dharma Shastra point of view, logic point of view, there are varied opinions about what should I do and what should I not do. And I'm utterly confused. So we had said that these are typical arguments we also give when we take to spirituality. And we also tend to think that I won't take to wholehearted Krishna consciousness right now. I want to do it, but I will do it later. And we give reasons. And these are the typical reasons we also put forward. We say that Manav Seva is Madhava Seva. First feed the hungry bellies of people, then talk about God. Compassion on bodily platform. Some people say about, oh, if I take to strict spiritual practices, what will happen to my enjoyment? I have so many habits and you know everything, and you will tell me to discipline myself, and I don't like discipline. That's too troublesome. So what will happen to my enjoyment? Then some of us fear that if we take to spiritual life wholeheartedly, then we may have to give up certain types of what we consider it as duties. And that may give me some sinful reaction. Often people worship gods that are not bona fide, for example. And if they have to give that up and take to genuine spiritual culture, then they think I'll get some sin. Then we also think that our family has some traditions, you know, that we want to maintain. On birthdays we have liquor parties, for example. And if I take to spiritual life, kulakshaya, destruction of family traditions will happen. And then finally we have indecision. Because, you know, so many people, so many pantha, as we call them, varied paths are there, and everybody has their opinion about everything. And they confuse us. We sometimes feel that, okay, everybody, you know, har ek koi aake apna danka bajata hai. How do you know what is true? So everybody, you go to this organization, they will say they are the best. You go to that organization, they say they are the best. So I am just utterly confused. I can't make a decision. Indecision. So because of indecision, I don't practice anything. Interesting. So like that, there are n number of ways we can postpone our relationship building with God. So, and these are all assumptions we have made. There is a saying, when you assume something, you are making an ass out of you and me. A-S-S-U-M-E. So we make assumptions about what spirituality is and what it is not, rather than taking to the actual standard scripture like Bhagavad Gita. This is world renowned. Nobody can debate whether this is a theistic spiritual science or not. Most authentic. And if we study it under proper guidance, we will see what is what. Just like in the noontime, if the sun is shining on our head, we can see everything clearly in life. So when one gets knowledge of Bhagavad Gita, he clearly understands these five fundamental truths of life. Ishvara, Jiva, Prakruti, Kala and Karma. So one who understands these five simple principles knows everything. He can make right decisions in most provoking situations of his life. And that is a real Superman. You understand? What is Superman? One who can make right choices in most provoking situations of life. He is a real Superman. So Bhagavad Gita gives us that ability. Yahi hai right choice, baby. Huh? What? Krishna consciousness. So if what is our problem? Dehatma buddhi. We think ourselves to be this body and the extensions of this body to be belonging to us. This is fundamental identity problem we have got. Bhagavad Gita teaches us what is our true identity. We are part and parcel of God. We are eternal servants of God. And this material body is a temporary designation we have acquired for some time. Now, coming to this verse, Arjuna is basically restating his argument. He says, O killer of enemies, O killer of Madhu, how can I counterattack with arrows in battle men like Bhishma and Drona who are worthy of my worship? So I told you, Arjuna is calling Krishna as Madhusudana and Arisudana. So he means that you have killed enemies in the past, but you have not killed Sandipani Muni or, you know, Vasudev or somebody like the Shurasen Maharaj, you know, of your own. You have not killed any of your relatives like that. So why are you telling me to kill my, you know, grandfather or my teacher? You are not Sandipani Sudan. So that's what Arjuna means. You are telling me to do something that you yourself would never do. But here there is a difficulty. Here these both personalities, Bhishma and Drona, are standing on the side of Adharma. That difference he is not able to consider because of being bewildered. So he says further, please repeat, Guru Nahatva Himahanubhavan.
Guru Nahatva Himahanubhavan.
श्रेयो भोक्तुम भैक्षमपि हलोके हत्वार्थकामांस्तु गुरु निहैव भुञ्जीय भोगान् रुधिर प्रदिग्धान्। प्लीज रीड ट्रांसलेशन। फाइव So he is considering Bhishma and Drona as gurun, great souls, and killing them and then living, having acquired a big kingdom, it is like enjoying remnants of food that is tainted by blood of our superiors. Rather I would beg and live. That is what Arjuna is meaning to say. For a kshatriya, you know, kshatriya never begs anything. Kshatriya takes. That is his mentality. He collects taxes. And he has that prowess. For him, begging is unthinkable. If you remember later on, during the war, when it is actually taking place, one point of time, Bhishma has given 5 arrows to Duryodhana. They are specifically meant for killing the Pandavas the next day. Duryodhana goes and agitates Bhishma, saying that you are not doing anything, you are very partial to them. So Bhishma says, okay, fine. Here are these 5 arrows. Tomorrow, Pandavas will be dead through them. I have empowered those arrows with certain mantras. So Duryodhana says, can I keep them with me? And he takes them to his camp. So Krishna is not able to rest at night. Why? Because he is worried about the future of his devotees. So Arjuna sees him going back and forth in the tent, and he wakes up and he says, what happened? Krishna, you sleep. You have no worries in life. He said, Bhishma has taken a vow to kill all of you, and I am worried how to counteract that weapon. And Arjuna says, what to do? Whatever you say. So the Krishna says, let's go to Duryodhana. We will beg those arrows from him. So it is said that they actually go to the camp of Duryodhana and he welcomes them. That is Kshatriya culture. Can you imagine? If you would go alone like that, they would kill you, right, in the night. But after sunset, no war. You are friends. You actually discuss how to do warfare better the next day, even with your enemy. That's their culture. Very sportive spirit. So they go, and then Duryodhana says, so what do you want, Arjuna? You want to get your kingdom back? You beg it from me, I will give it to you. Arjuna says, no. That is the, you know, I have come to only ask for you one thing. You remember when I had saved you during the Chitrasen Gandharva's battle? You had promised me that you will give me something that I ask for. Duryodhana says, yes. What do you want? He says, give me those 5 arrows. So in this way, begging is unthinkable for a kshatriya. And here he is saying, Arjuna, it's better for me to beg and live in this world than to kill my superiors like Bhishma and Drona. Na chaitad vidma katarano gariyo yadva jayema yadivano jayeyuhu याने वहत्वा नजिजीविशामः तेवस्थिता प्रमुखे धार्तराष्ट्रा। ट्रांसलेशन।
नॉट वी नो विच इज बेटर कंकरिंग देम और बीइंग कंकर्ड बाय देम। इफ वी किल्ड द सन्स ऑफ धृतराष्ट्र वी शुड नॉट केयर टू लिव येट दे आर are now standing before us on the battlefield.
So this is that argument of indecision. I do not know which is better, to conquer them or be conquered by them. On one hand, we can see that Arjuna, although he is a royal personality, a big powerful administrator of a kingdom, he simultaneously has detachment in his heart. He is not just power hungry. Just for the sake of power, you kill anybody, do any damn thing. He is not that type of a person. So he is actually very detached, although he has so much opulence. This is sign of a person who is fit for receiving transcendental knowledge. That is why Arjuna is given the knowledge of Bhagavad Gita. In other words, we have a marker. There are three ways to look at this world. One is called Jnana Marga. Jnana Marga teaches us that we should demonize this material world. What do you mean demonize? Oh, everything in this world is meant to give us suffering, and desire is the cause of, you know, misery. Sari ichhaon ko daba do. Yeah. You know, everything in this world can potentially be dangerous for you. So you detach yourself from all that is worldly and leave it and practice some cultivation of knowledge and detachment. So this is called Jnana Marga. It demonizes the material world. Another is called Karma Marga. The path of Karma Marga tells that it romanticizes the material world. It tells us, well, there are some problems in this world, no doubt. If we could set a few things here and there right, we could actually enjoy this world. It's not all that bad. You see? So there are people who think like that. That's called Karma Marga. Let's make things better here. So that is their mentality. And there is a third path called Bhakti. Jnana Marga demonizes the world. Karma Marga romanticizes the world. Bhakti Marga utilizes the world. It has a basic philosophy that this world and its paraphernalia doesn't belong to us. It belongs to the Supreme Lord. And it is meant for His service. So if you get great opulence in your life, you have so much wealth and fame and power and beauty and physique, you know, good body. What do? You demonize that? You romanticize that? You want to, you know, get into enjoying through that? No, you just utilize it for its purpose, for the service. And sometimes if you don't have certain things, you know, some of us hoped that I should have been a little more intelligent than I am and a little more fair complexion than I am and a little more whatever, moneyed than I am. So we don't have to get depressed about that either. We just utilize whatever we have got in our life. So in this way, Bhakti Marga is actually the safest, easiest, direct and enjoyable path of leading our life. If we fall into any of these traps, we will have to eventually come to the track of Bhakti, but we will have to spend a huge amount of time taking trouble in sorting out what to do with this world. So that's why indecision is generally because of these reasons. We are either trying to demonize, for example, let's say you have a colleague and he's giving you a hard time. So what is our tendency? We demonize such a person. And sometimes if there is a person who is very favorably or there is a facility which you can enjoy, then we try to romanticize that. So in this way, either way we can become entangled. But if we have this understanding that nothing is meant for personal enjoyment, it is meant to be used in service. So we take what is needed for self-preservation and continue our self-realization business. Now comes the classic verse of Bhagavad Gita. If ever in your life you became overcome by some kind of weakness of heart, you can recite this shloka. Especially, take to the process of consulting a superior. Karpanya dosho pahata svabhava. Pruchhami tvam dharma sammoodha chetaha. Yachreyasyan nishchitam bruhitanme. Shishyasteham shadhimam tvam prapannam. Translation. Miserly weakness.
In this condition, I am asking you to tell me for certain what is best for me. Now I am your disciple and a soul surrendered unto you. Please instruct me.
This is an ideal state of consciousness to approach a guru, a spiritual master. And this purport I had told you, the homework, has got one word most often: perplexity. Any of you did that homework? How many times? Yes? 10 times in one purport. The word perplexity comes. By nature's own way, the complete system of material activities is a source of perplexity for everyone. By nature, this material world is perplexing. In every step, there is perplexity. Therefore, it behooves one to approach a bona fide spiritual master who can give one proper guidance for executing the purpose of life. You remember, in our life we have all gone through certain perplexities, crucial choices we had to make. Which school we take admission into, which spouse we marry, which location in Pune we stay, you know, making our home. And even today, before coming for the class, we had a choice: should we really go to the class or not? We could be doing so many other things. So in this way, moment to moment, life offers us choices, and these choices could become a source of perplexity when we are not having single pointed determination or a clear vision of our life. Where am I supposed to be going? So Bhagavad Gita and spiritual master, guru, their position is like that of a, you know, when the flight takes off, they have this ground level feedback system, what they call it? Control room. Yeah, control room. So the control room, what is its job? It keeps telling you whether you are on course or off course. Right? That's the job of the control room. So we have our independence to fly our life, the airplane of our life. But we have to be in touch with a control room. Because up there in the sky, everything looks same. You know? And we could be going, but we don't know where we are going to land up if you are not in touch with the control room. So Bhagavad Gita and the spiritual master, they act like the control room that guide with proper feedback system our navigation of our life. What do they exactly do to us in our life?
We are talking here about Bhagavad Gita or a guru, a spiritual master.
What is their job description? In our life, they do 3 things. They validate, they optimize, and they navigate. Our life. As I said, we all have to make choices. So first we need somebody to validate whether this choice is good or not. You understand validation? We need some absolute source in reference to which we can make every decision, and when that reference is cross-checked, it never cheats us. It's an absolute knowledge. It's not relative mundane knowledge which keeps changing every now and then. So that is Bhagavad Gita or Guru. They validate our choices that we make in our life. So we can just refer to. And if they say, oh, that's good, validate, we do it. Second, they optimize. Having, let's say, taken up a job of, say, parenting. It's not a job, I'm saying in terms of a service. Now, parenting could be done so many ways. There's permissive parenting, aggressive parenting, passive parenting, you know, varieties of the. So, in a given situation, one particular choice is optimum. You know, you understand what is optimizing something? Just like if you get fever, there could be 15 medicines. But there is one amongst them that works the best for your particular situation. That is called optimization. So all are valid, but one is the best amongst them. So that is what they do to our life. They optimize. The spiritual master optimizes whatever we are handling in our life. Our food choices, our anything. They tell us how we can do it the best way without having to hassle too much, wasting our time, figuring out this, figuring out that. They optimize the impact. And then they navigate. Navigate refers to what I said just now. Stay in touch with the control room. They have a feedback system. And we know from here to there I have to go. Then while on course, they keep us guiding. And the moment we go off course, they tell us there are warning signals. That don't do that. You'll go somewhere else. So this is what happens in our life if we take to the study of Bhagavad Gita under the guidance of a bona fide spiritual master. In every step there is perplexity. Therefore it behooves one to approach a bona fide spiritual master who can give one proper guidance for executing the purpose of life. The material world, the world situation is such that perplexities of life automatically appear without our wanting such confusion. No one wants fire, yet it takes place and we become perplexed. The Vedic wisdom therefore advises that in order to solve the perplexities of life and to understand the science of the solution, one must approach a guru. Here is an interesting verse. Yova etad aksharam gargi aviditvasma lokat praiti sa krupanaha. He is a miserly man who does not solve the problems of life as a human and who thus quits this world like cats and dogs without understanding the science of self-realization. Krupana means miser. Brahmana means broad-minded. Miser, mean-minded. Someone who has got great fortune, but he keeps it locked, never uses, either for his personal benefit or for others, he is called miser. So most people have this human birth, and the greatest asset of this human life is athato brahma jidnyasa. That asset is kept locked. And we do every other business like cats and dogs. Eating, sleeping, mating, defending in sophisticated ways. But that doesn't solve the real problems of life. What are the real problems of life? Birth, old age, disease and death. We don't even try to address this problem. Adhyatmik, adhibhautik, adhidaivik, miseries. And that is what is called a krupana. One who does not use the valuable asset for its purpose. I earlier gave that example. If you had a friend who was poor and if you became rich, you gave a Mercedes Benz to him as a gift. And he was a poor farmer who used that Mercedes for plowing his fields. Yeah? Imagine. Hal jot ke wo Mercedes ko khet mein dal kar usne chalaya usko. After 1 year, you go back to see what happened. You know, except horn, everything is making sound in the car. You'll again give him that vehicle. You'll take it back. You'll say, "Hey, tumko khet mein chalna tha to tractor le." Mercedes Benz is for a fine vehicle meant for a fine purpose. Similarly, this human body is a fine vehicle. It is meant for self-realization. And other bodies, cats, dogs, rats, non-human species, they are meant for the business of sense enjoyment. So the sense enjoyment business is compared to kheti, and self-realization business is compared to express highway driving. So if you want to do that business, then material nature, prakruti, gives us, well, we have been given human body right now, Mercedes-Benz, but we are using it for that purpose, animalistic purpose. So what does the prakruti do? बोलते तुमको यही काम करना है ना, खाना है, सोना है, मैथुन करना है, तो इसके लिए ह्यूमन बॉडी लेके क्यों बैठे तुम? क्योंकि इसमें बहुत लिमिटेशंस है, कितना खा सकते हैं हम लोग? हाथी कितना खा सकता है? और कितना मैथुन कर सकते हैं हम लोग? पिजन्स, पीकॉक्स, दे कैन डू सो मेनी टाइम्स इन अ डे. एंड हाउ मच कैन वी रियली स्लीप इवन इफ यू वॉन्ट टू स्लीप? बट यू नो पोलार बेयर्स, दे कैन स्लीप 6 months एंड दे डोंट हैव एग्जाम टेंशन. नो एग्जाम्स टू गिव, no job to do, no share market tension, you know, just sleep, peaceful, so nice. So that is how nature says, take away this body, human body, give that body to that fellow, because it's meant for that business only. So modern times people think they have become superior just because they have technology. No, that is not superiority. Superiority is decided by our consciousness. What is our thought process inside? So if that thought process is like animals, then a person is considered dvipada pashu, two-legged animal. So Bhagavad Gita is telling us, we should not remain a krupana, a miser, who uses the great facility of human life for the business of animalistic activities. We should become rather much elevated and use this facility for its purpose. Ya etad aksharam gargi विदित्वास्मा लोकात् प्रैति स ब्राह्मणः. ऑन द अदर हैंड देयर इज अ ब्राह्मण, ही हु इज इंटेलिजेंट इनफ टू यूटिलाइज दिस बॉडी टू सॉल्व ऑल द प्रॉब्लम्स ऑफ लाइफ. नाउ although Arjuna could understand that his duty to fight was awaiting him, still on account of miserly weakness, that is bodily attachment, he could not discharge his duty. He is therefore asking Lord Krishna, the Supreme Spiritual Master, to make a definite solution. He offers himself to Krishna as a disciple. He wants to stop friendly talks. Talks between master and disciple are serious. Now Arjuna wants to talk very seriously before the recognized spiritual master. Krishna is the supreme spiritual master, and yet foolish mundane scholars explain that one need not submit to Krishna as a person, but to the unborn within Krishna. There is no difference between Krishna's within and without. One who has no sense of this understanding is the greatest fool in trying to understand Bhagavad Gita. So what is Krupana mentality in short? Mean-mindedness. What are we mean-minded about? Not utilizing our human life to its full potential. We limit ourselves by simply going on performing materialistic life and its activities. We are limiting our potential. That is called a krupana. We should rather unleash the spiritual potential that is dormant, which can be especially realized in human birth and not in any other birth. And that is the purpose of our life. And that is why Prabhupada says, for that purpose of life to get fulfilled, we need a bona fide spiritual master. Now, Arjuna has already surrendered. He says, Shishyaste aham shadhimam tvam prapannam. I am your disciple, no more friendly talks, I am surrendering unto you. Tell me definitely what to do and I will do it. The meaning of accepting spiritual master is guru. You heard this word guru? Guru means heavy. The technical meaning of guru is heavy. So if you take a scale and on the scale you put opinions of the whole world on one side and you put the opinion of the guru on another side, who weighs heavy? Guru. That's why he's called guru. You follow that instruction that is given by the spiritual master because his instruction is loaded in terms of absolute truth being spoken. So Arjuna has already surrendered. It is necessary to surrender. Sometimes we tend to think, okay, we have some guru like a fashion, you know. In modern times, people, you know, they take you to their homes and they show you, you know, that is my grandfather, you know, old picture. This is my father. This is my wife. That's my children. That's my dog. And that's my guru. So that's also one of the fashion, you know. One of the things. It's fashionable to have a guru, you know. Guru is not a fashion. Guru, when you accept somebody as guru, it means that that person's opinion weighs heavy and you live by it in your life. That is the meaning of accepting a guru. And his instruction presides over everything. So unless one is so convinced about some person whom he can take like that in his life, he should not accept a guru. There is no need to make a show bottle business. One can wait till then, till one finds such a person. But once you find, no friendly talk, like Arjuna was doing. One must actually submit and do his will. Just like, if I want to learn tabla or karate, can I just read some book and learn? Can I just, you know, just get some instrument somehow and beat it, you know, this way, that way and try and figure it out? Not possible. I must submit to some teacher, and if he tells me, ये 50 बार ये चीज को 50 बार इस तरीके से बजाना है, चुपचाप बजाओ. हम प्रश्न नहीं पूछते उसको ज्यादा, ऐसा क्यों ऐसा क्यों. ओवर द पीरियड ऑफ लर्निंग वी गेट सम साक्षात्कार रियलाइजेशंस एंड देन वी अंडरस्टैंड, माय गॉड, ही टॉट इट, इट वाज राइट, दैट वाज टू बी लर्न लाइक दैट ओनली. सो दैट इज हाउ इट इज विद द फील्ड ऑफ स्पिरिचुअलिटी ऑल्सो. वी सबमिट, वी प्रैक्टिस, वी गेट रियलाइजेशन एंड वी सी हाउ ट्रू इट वॉज दैट इट वॉज टू बी डन लाइक दैट. नेक्स्ट वर्स, नहि प्रपश्यामि ममापनुद्यात् यच्छोकमुच्छोषणमिन्द्रियाणाम् अवाप्य भूमावसपत्नवृद्धम् राज्यं सुराणामपि चाधिपत्यम्. ट्रांसलेशन. This is a very important purport. You see, in the previous verse, Arjuna already surrendered. Krishna was telling, oh, you know so much Dharma Shastra, you sort out your problem yourself. Dharma sammoodha chetaha. My mind is finished, I can't think straight. Then Krishna said, but earlier I told some arguments and you smashed them. And what if I teach you something more and you again smash my idea? Shishyasteham. Now this time I am your disciple. Not no more friendly talk. So he has done that. But still Krishna doesn't go ahead. He doesn't speak a word. Why? Because Krishna is waiting for one more thing in Arjuna. And that is, what do you really want? Even if you surrender to a guru, what are you seeking from him? Many a times people are seeking material benefit. They go to guru, but they want to get their disease cured, promotion sorted, you know, or some kind of mundane benefit they are seeking, even in a spiritual organization or a spiritual personality. So Krishna is not yet convinced. What does Arjuna exactly want, even if he surrenders? So Krishna means to say that, oh, you just fight, you will win, and when you enjoy kingdom, that time you will forget all this that happened, you know, all this grief and this and that. So bhul jaoge tum. Arjuna says, no, Krishna, it's not just a matter of fighting this battle. I actually want transcendental knowledge, by having which I can make all decisions in my future life perfectly. You give me that knowledge. It is not just a matter of this one situation that I'm talking to you about. I actually want transcendental knowledge. I don't want Rajya, and I don't want freedom from this anxiety that I'm going through. I actually want transcendental knowledge. And that is what is he saying in this verse. Now there is a beautiful, important line in the purport. Read it from here. It was impossible for Arjuna to solve such perplexities without the help of a guru like Lord Krishna. Now this is the line. Academic knowledge, scholarship, high position, etc. are all useless in solving the problems of life. Help can be given only by a spiritual master like Krishna. Therefore, the conclusion is that a spiritual master who is 100% Krishna conscious is a bona fide spiritual master, for he can solve the problems of life. So think about it. Arjuna had high birth, aristocratic family, born to King Pandu, ruler of the world. Arjuna had high class academic knowledge. He is quoting Nyaya Shastra, Dharma Shastra, Artha Shastra left and right. He knows everything. Arjuna had bodily beauty and prowess. He was a powerful Kshatriya. You know, all these modern WWF champions are nothing in front of him. And then Arjuna had even aristocratic relatives, very powerful people to be with. And he especially had a very high position himself. Despite all that, when he was in crisis, he couldn't solve it all by himself. Similarly, in our life, there will be this called a checkmate situations, where we may be whatever we are, still we cannot address sometimes even the basic problems of our life. For example, giving up bad habits, sorting out some relationship issues, not getting exact direction, orientation in which to do our service contribution to society. And these are the times, no matter how much qualified we are, we'll have to put that aside and submit to someone who is spiritually enlightened and seek guidance. And that is what is being stressed here. And the result or the reason for which we should submit is transcendental knowledge. Last purport of this paragraph. If we want to curb lamentation for good, we have to take shelter of Krishna, as Arjuna is seeking to do so. Text 9. Any comments or questions so far? Any question? We go to the next verse. Sanjaya uvacha eva muktva rushikesham gudakeshah parantapah nayotsya iti govindam uktva tushnim babhuvah. Translation. So you please remember, this whole narration is being told to whom? Dhritarashtra by Sanjay. So Dhritarashtra must have been very glad to understand Arjuna was not going to fight, was instead of leaving the battlefield to for begging profession. Right? That's why Sanjaya is calling Krishna, Sanjaya is calling Arjuna as Parantapa and he is calling Krishna as Rishikesha in this verse. What does that mean? Krishna is the master of all senses, he guides everybody's senses. So although Arjuna is currently bewildered, Krishna, who is the master of his senses, is going to direct him properly. And what is going to happen? Arjuna is Parantapa. He can chastise any kind of enemy in battlefield. And he is going to become victorious. So Sanjaya is kind of giving his purport. Because Dhritarashtra is becoming too happy. Ki aisa ho gaya, are hari bol. Very nice. But wait a minute, sir. There is Rishikesha and Parantapa. They are powerful combination for each other. So that is what Sanjaya is thinking in his mind, the secretary of Dhritarashtra. Now, text 10. Tamuvacha Rishikeshah Prahasanniva Bharata Senayorubhayor Madhye Vishidantam Idam Vachah. Translation. So this shloka is technically called as rasa sandhi. It connects two rasas which are different from each other with one shloka. The earlier rasa was friendly rasa. Prahasanniva. Krishna was smiling. He's looking at his friend. My poor friend. What has gone wrong with him? You know, in that mood he's thinking about him. And now suddenly this friend has told, you are my guru, I am your disciple, I am surrendering unto you. Please tell me definitely what am I supposed to be doing. At that time, Krishna's smile turns into a grim, which means he becomes serious. So earlier he was in a friendly mood, now Krishna becomes, actually he takes on the role of a guru. And the talks between guru and disciple are serious. They are not frivolous. So Krishna becomes grim and he is expert at playing any role perfectly. When he's a friend, perfect. When he becomes a guru, perfect guru. And that is why the role is now changing from Sakhyaras to the Dasya, guru and disciple relationship. And that is why Krishna begins to speak. This is last few lines of the purport. It appears that talk between master and disciple were openly exchanged in the presence of both armies so that all could be benefited. This goes to show that Bhagavad Gita was not just spoken to Arjuna, it was actually spoken to the whole of the armies. Now you may say, itana sound system tha kya unke paas? Kyunki there are so many lakhs and crores of warriors on the battlefield. And you know, one person speaking in one place, how can everybody hear? First of all, who's speaking is Krishna. Point number one. He can speak to you from any distance and you can hear it clear. Because he's situated in our heart as Paramatma. Besides that, in those days, there was no need of sound systems. You know why? Because the ether was not polluted by rubbish sound that we keep producing all the time. Our ether now is polluted by so many sound waves. Radio, TV, internet. They are sound waves basically. And besides that, so much prajalpa people do. You know? And that's how the ether becomes contaminated. And then it's like a traffic jam for your additional sound to reach somewhere else. You get it? It's already polluted, crowded. And that is why we need sound systems. Even in this one small room, you have to use a sound system. But in Vedic culture, ether was so pure that actually even now you go to a village, if a person is sitting in one place, a kilometer ahead you can hear his voice, what he's talking. You know that? You go to a village setting in some jungle or whatever. If two people are talking, you can actually hear what they are talking, although they are far off from you. Because there the atmospheric ether is clean, not contaminated. So it's an interesting one that Krishna is speaking to everybody, not just to Arjuna. And he's also speaking to us now 5,000 years later. 5,116 years of Kali Yuga have passed. And till date, this dialogue is ever fresh for whoever reads it. That is the quality of this dialogue. So I would like to conclude with a wonderful and instructive story. Why should we surrender to a guru? The story begins in the place of, I think it is Japan. There is a boy named Sensei. And this boy had a great desire to learn martial arts. So, he was searching for a teacher, guru, and he was going everywhere. Monastery to monastery, finding out who can accept him. But he had one serious problem. He had no left hand. He had only one hand. So every monastery he would go to, they would generally not take him. But he had a strong urge. I want to become world champion in martial arts. So there was one monastery he had heard a lot about. It was in some remote corner of the country. So he decided, I'll give it a try. So he went to that place, and the monastery was really high up in the mountain and not much good facility. And it was closed when he went. It was evening time. And he knocked on the door pathetically, frantically. Nobody opened the door. So he went and sat on the stone nearby and waited. And that night passed. It was chill, cold, winter. Somehow he survived. The next day morning, one old man came out of that monastery and he was doing grooming of the floor outside. So this boy got up, ran to him. He said, sir, I have come from a long distance. I have a great desire to learn martial arts. Please take me inside this monastery and train me up. That man did not even look at him. He continued grooming. When he finished his grooming, he went inside and locked the monastery. And these are too much. And he didn't know what next. So he went and again sat on the stone there and waited. And he had hunger, you're not eaten, so many problems, this, that. He survived. That one more night he survived. Next day morning again that fellow came out. Same story. He's brooming, he's going and pleading. He didn't even look at him. He broomed, went inside, locked the door. And then he broke down, he went and sat on the stone, started crying. He said, what will happen? And he was really desperate. He wanted to learn. It was not that he was going back. He had decided that I will not go back till they take me inside. I will die here at the outside of this monastery. So in the noon sometime, the monastery door again opened. Two boys came out. They grabbed him by the shirt and they took him inside. And then they introduced him to the chief of that monastery, and he was that old man, who had come for brooming outside. And he was shocked. He said, this is the master here? They said, yes. And that old man had such tejas, effulgence on his face. And he was so powerful. Although he was thin, he was very, very powerful. So then he bowed down before him. And there was a brief interview. And the old man, that chief, he told him, so from today onwards, I shall teach you. You have to promise me that you will practice it diligently and not question anything that I teach. He said, all right. So he started learning. So this boy was taught by the master only one move. And he was trying to do that. One day, 2 day, month, 2 months passed. Their other fellow students were learning much more in the same time. But this master never taught him another step. This is one step that he had taught him. And he went on learning. And by that time he had mastered it also. He had tried on everybody in the monastery. And they had been defeated by him when he used that move. So he was wondering, why is he not teaching me further? So like that, 6 months passed. He is just doing one move. In the martial arts there are moves. one point of time he got exasperated. He said, am I so gone case that I am not fit for learning more, that my guru doesn't teach me? What is the problem? Why doesn't he even explain to me? Why is this? But he had faith. Somehow he continued. So it is said, he never questioned. One full year he was trained. He did nothing but that one move. And after that 1 year was over, the master introduced, he enrolled his name for the world championship, you know, tournament in martial arts. And he was shocked. He said, this is something interesting. So he went for the tournament. Lo behold, he won the first half, quarter final, semi final. Finally, he went to the finals. There he met face to face across the world champion in martial arts. And that fellow's body was so dexterous. And he was like a lightning bolt, you know, in his movements and everything. He was so just too powerful. Simply to see him, you'll get afraid because, you know, he can kill you. So this boy was not getting his courage. Bola, ek hi move aata hai. That fellow knows so much. And what am I going to do in front of him? So it is said that there was a huge stadium. Everybody's eyes were fixed on this match. This was first time ever in the history that a man who had no left arm had come for a tournament and he had gone to the finals. That was a national news. Everybody was watching. And then the two came in front of him. So before that, the guru met and he gave him a pep talk. He said, remember that one move and do it. You will be victorious. He said, okay. He went there. And then amazingly, that fellow opponent came in front of him and this fellow applied his move and that fellow was finished. He was on the ground. And for a moment, nobody understood what happened. And after digesting the shock, the whole stadium stood up, started clapping. And, oh my God, what did this fellow do? You know, they were not getting. And he himself was shocked. He was looking at himself, what happened? So then he ran to his guru, embracing him tightly, started crying. And then he was given a gold medal. They came back to their monastery. And he just couldn't digest what had happened. So he went to his guru in the night and he asked him, can you explain, give some purport, you know, the whole thing, you know, last 1 year I've been going through so much. You know, can I know what is happening with me? So the guru explained, he said that this one move that you have learnt, there are two reasons why you won. He said, you have practiced it so much that there is nobody on this planet who can defeat you. Then you make that move, nobody can defeat you. You are really pakka in this move. Second, he said, there is a counter move to counter attack you. But that move requires that the person should have his left arm, which the opponent has to grab. Only then he can defeat. But because you don't have your left arm, by the time he realizes, ki are, pakada kidhar isko, by that time he's finished. And that is the reason why you went on winning every tournament. And this boy broke to tears, he started crying, you know, he was thinking, my God, what a glorious master I have got. I was doubting him unnecessarily, you know, he has been not telling me what am I doing, why am I doing all that. So, this is called the story of the sensei who won the world championship. There are many important lessons from this story which I want to hear from you. What's the first lesson? Okay, don't ever give up. If you get good instructions from your superiors, at least daily when you come for the class, take one thing and that thing you diligently apply and you will see the benefits that it works. So never give up. Perseverance, yeah. Never giving up. Well, we should not sell our intelligence to our guru. We should surrender with intelligence. We should not surrender intelligence, but we should surrender with intelligence. It's not that anything is okay, but at the same time it is true that before you accept, you test. You have full rights to test. Guru will test you, you will also test your guru. But once you accept, then you should follow. Very nice. Any other? One very important lesson. Okay, total obedience. Having faith in the
undying
faith. Yes, Anupro.
Guru knows how to turn your adversity into opportunity.
Wow, that was what I was looking for. Guru knows how to turn your handicap into an asset. Sometimes we are bogged down with our handicaps. You know, I can't do this, I can't, I'm like this, I'm like that. Chill. If you go to a good teacher, he knows how to utilize your natural propensities, capabilities to your advantage, to help you become a better person. Prabhupada, when he went to America, he met these hippies. Now, who are hippies? They are young boys and girls coming from rich families but practicing counterculture. All kinds of bad habits, weird lifestyles, and music, drugs, sex. That's it. They don't know anything outside that. And to such people, can you imagine, you have to teach Bhagavad Gita. I am very fortunate to have wonderful, you know, people like all of you, you know, coming and hearing very nicely. Imagine a bunch of hippies, you know, sitting in your class, and you have to tell them any of these things. So Prabhupada, he was such an amazing person. He always saw a little spark and he fanned it till it became a big fire, blazing fire. The huge heaps of impurities that those people were carrying, he would not look at them. And this is how he transformed many such hippies into great Vaishnavas who became eventually world-renowned spiritual masters. Forget about anything else in this world. And this was his speciality. When Prabhupada met George Harrison, one of the Beatles, he asked him, how do I know who is a guru? Bona fide guru. And Prabhupada said, just see who is most addicted to God. It's an interesting answer to be given to a hippie. Just see who is most addicted to God. We cannot live without thought of him and service to him. That person is a bona fide guru. So, another time, this is in those days of ISKCON when Prabhupada had just gone to America and the hippies were the original first audience, you know, that is coming to learn spirituality. There was two good things about hippies, no matter what they had. One good thing was, they were seeking pleasure beyond matter, but they didn't know where it exists. They wanted some, they had a conception of stay high forever. Which means they didn't want to have any pleasure that is brings you back again, you know, in this reality. So they were experimenting with drugs because they didn't know that this doesn't work. They were misguided by their leaders. And another good thing about a hippie was they were really renounced. No material attachments. You know, it's an interesting phenomenon to have somebody like that. And then Prabhupada went to America and he introduced Krishna. Now hippies have this habit, they wear various types of beads and, you know, colorful dresses, and they put all kinds of feathers and, you know, colors in their body and whatever, tattoos, all that. So when Prabhupada introduced Krishna, he was a very fascinating god for them. Because God was a musician, he has a flute that he plays. Just like them, he had a girlfriend on his side, Srimati Radharani. That was interesting. And he was a blue boy who is a cowherd, a cowboy, you know, in Vrindavan. They said, wow, that's fascinating. And then Prabhupada said that he wears a yellow dhoti. Now, yellow is not a pant color, right? Generally, nobody likes to wear that. Pitambar. And apart from that, he has a long hair, curly locks of hair. Hippies like long hair, even men especially, they had long hair. And he wears, of all kinds of feathers you can wear, a peacock feather in the hair. Oh, that was too hip. You know, according to the hippies. It's too great. No, wonderful. And in this way, when Krishna was introduced to them, they found this is a pakka hippie god. interesting one. All characteristic match. He's a musician. He's a girlfriend. All what are the bona fide characteristics, you know, that should exist. All existed. And in this way, they're fascinated. And Prabhupada would teach them. So, you want to stay high forever, you must give up illicit sex, intoxication, meat eating, and gambling. And you should chant Hare Krishna. If you chant Hare Krishna, this spiritual sound vibration comes from another stratum. It's not from this material world. It can connect your soul to transcendence. And by sincerely chanting, one experiences pleasure which is beyond matter. The more attentively and prayerfully we chant, we can get a higher taste in chanting. This is a non-material source of pleasure you should experiment with. On and on, Prabhupada introduced all these Vedic concepts of vegetarian food, prasadam, deity worship, chanting holy names, studying Bhagavad Gita, the spiritual sound vibration of Vedic mantras. And they went on accepting whatever he was giving. And our lifestyle for them was also quite hip. 4 o'clock you wake up in the morning, take bath, and first thing you do in the day is to dance. Wow! 4:30 a.m. How many of you come to temple? 4:30 a.m. in the morning. First thing we do after we wake up is to sing and dance. Now that's, and who has that lifestyle in the world? No matter how rich a person, ki aap to utke pehla kaam karte naachte hai. That's quite an interesting thing to do in life. And the prasad that we have is quite exotic. The tastes and the, you know, flavors, they have never tested anything like that in America. Americans know only 2 spices, salt and pepper. And take out some dead piece of meat, frozen for days in the refrigerator, and sprinkle something, put it in the oven and eat like a cannibal. This is no lifestyle. Fine food, you know, Vedic cuisine, people will paint chutney ka 1000 type hai, rice ke 50,000 types. You know, can you imagine what kind of cuisine is this? So like that. So they were all exotically intoxicated by spiritual culture. They said, we never tested and experienced anything like this. And gradually as they started practicing spiritual culture, they became so pro at it and so pure hearted that he completely transformed them. And what was their so-called lacking? That they were too detached and that they were too otherworldly, you know, seeking some pleasure other than this world. It was actually turned into their advantage by Prabhupada. At the age of 21, some of them were given sannyas by Prabhupada. You know, in India, to give sannyas, it's a big issue. And in this way, they became world-renowned preachers and they spread Krishna consciousness far and wide. One time, Prabhupada was taken by some of his disciples. He didn't know where he's been taken. So he's, whoever these young boys would ask him, Swamiji, can we take you to our friends there? We have a program. So he'll say, okay, take me. So he was also in his experimental stages. He didn't know much about America and their culture. One time they took him to a nudist club. They were staying in jungle. So Prabhupada sang Jai Radha Madhava. And after singing Jai Radha Madhava, he opened his eyes. He saw all these, you know, men, women, dude, all sitting around. So what to do? That's your audience. Huh? See, if any of us go and preach in such places, forget Krishna. We will not even maintain basic purity in our life. Prabhupada was such a powerful acharya. And then he started speaking. So, all of you have experience. When you take off all your clothes and enjoy with your bare senses, how much pleasure is there? They said, yes, that we know. Very much. Similarly, Prabhupada said, this material body is a covering on the soul. It's a dress. And the soul has got spiritual senses. Imagine if you take off this covering also and enjoy with your spiritual senses, how much pleasure is there? They said, yes, Swamiji, we understood that also. So Prabhupada said, that is the purpose of practicing spiritual culture. This material body actually inhibits our pleasure. Because the senses that we are carrying are actually, it's just like if you have an electron microscope and somebody puts some mud on the lens, can you really see anything? So with spiritual senses that we have, this matter is actually a covering upon it. And then we are trying to interact with sources of pleasure. It doesn't bring pleasure. But if that covering is removed and you actually have the original senses, you can enjoy so much. And that is the process of chanting Hare Krishna and practicing spirituality. So this is how Prabhupada preached to his audience. And he created a revolution in the impious life of a misdirected civilization. What American government, with all their money, army, educational, political, governance systems, could not accomplish about their own younger generation was done by one old Indian man, age 72, to turn hippies into happies. Prabhupada used to say, this is my miracle. Some people have some jadu tona, they do. Not a big deal. You can transform gross matter this way, that way. That doesn't make you a good guru. The real guru is one who causes transformation of consciousness. Most difficult thing to transform. Somebody's materialistic consciousness into Krishna consciousness. Thank you all very much. We end here. Questions?
Romanticizing life. Isn't it that all these are different paths to reach the same goal? That is, self-realization is the be all and end all.
Yes, they are.
And these are ways, depending upon the capacity of the intellectual, can reach this.
It is true that the aim is self-realization, but what is that realization that you get differs according to the generally speaking, Jnana Yogis and Karma Yogis reach to Brahman realization. Then there is one more fellow in between, Ashtanga Yoga. They reach to Paramatma realization, and the Bhakti Yogis reach to Bhagavan realization. We discussed this earlier. Brahman, Paramatma, Bhagavan are the three features of the same absolute truth. So Brahman is like Bill Gates being realized through the policies in the company. That he exists and he controls. He's all pervading through the systems and policies. Paramatma is like knowing Bill Gates, who appears on every screen in the company, every computer, and gives instructions one-on-one to every employee. At any time he can do that. That's his all-pervading nature. In the heart of everyone, the Lord is situated. That's Paramatma. And Bhagavan feature is like Bill Gates being in the Switzerland, doing ice skating, having nothing to do with the company that is running somewhere, enjoying his life. So Krishna is Bhagavan feature that we want to worship and realize. And that feature of absolute truth is most relishable. So there is nothing wrong in realizing God as Brahman or as Paramatma or as Bhagavan. All are absolute. It's just the choice of you. You can decide what you want. Because the Bhagavan realization includes and surpasses the Brahman and Paramatma realization. So that is why we take to Bhakti Yoga. So Jnana and Karma generally give Brahman realization in the Vedic traditional path. Ashtanga Yoga, which I have not written here, gives Paramatma realization, and Bhakti Yoga gives you Bhagavan realization. Goal is same, paths are different, but the relish and revelation of that absolute truth varies depending on the path. Correct. This Jnana that we are getting is Bhakti Jnana. It is not just analytical study of matter and spirit. It is in connection with service to the Lord, love to God. It is not separated from it. So that is why it is bhakti, bhakti jnana. So Vasudeve Bhagavati Bhakti Yoga Prayojitaha Janayati Ashu Vairagyam Jnanam Cha Yad Ahaitukam. So this is in Bhagavatam. If you do service, bhakti yoga, to Lord Vasudeva, janayati, it generates, ashu, very quickly, vairagyam, detachment, and jnanam. So jnana is not imperative for bhakti, not a necessary qualification. But if you practice bhakti, you will get transcendental knowledge. That is inbuilt in bhakti. Janayati ashu vairagyam jnanam cha yad ahaitukam. One gets causeless knowledge and detachment if he practices bhakti yoga. Dwapar. Krishna appeared at the end of Dwapar Yuga. Satya, Treta, Dwapara, Kali. Krishna appeared at the end of Dwapar Yuga. Then he went back to spiritual world, winding up his pastimes. Krishna never takes birth, never dies. He's always present. He just appears and disappears. Just like sun never dies. It just appears to our vision and disappears from our vision. He existing somewhere else, all the time. And Kali Yuga began after Dwapar Yuga. 5,116 years have passed. And there are about 4,27,000 years more to go. That's quite a bit. Nikal chalo. Practice spiritual culture and go back to spiritual world. Don't rot here. Yes? Optimization, navigation. I don't know about management so much, but the principle is what we are talking about. So one can plan based on what one can validate and organize to optimize like that. Correct. Yeah, that's a managerial purview. Yes? No. Bhakti Yoga is independent of any other system. It does not require support of anything else. You see the example of Mrugari, the hunter. He was a jungle animal, jungle hunter, killing animals. Narad Muni went and gave him chanting of the holy names. He became a wonderful Vaishnava. It was not that he cultivated Jnana or he did some Karma Yoga and then he became a devotee. So we can go on giving so many examples of personalities without taking shelter of any other process. We can practice Bhakti Yoga. Bhakti Yoga is self-sufficient, fully independent, and fully effective in itself. It does not require support of any other system. If you want, you can study 4th chapter of Nectar of Devotion, Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, chapter 4, The Purity of Devotional Service. Yes. True.
So they become conducive in doing that.
Yes. Yes. Correct. So karma is called thesis. Jnana is called antithesis. And bhakti is called synthesis. If you really want to get into philosophy. Thesis means this world is real and I have something to do with it. So what am I supposed to do? The general by default setting is enjoy. Right? So that is thesis. But those who have gone ahead and enjoyed, what is the result? If you really observe that in this world, the moment you pick up any object for enjoyment, the flip side of the coin is misery. Take any object, car, you know, a gadget, you know, whatever. So it's like a head and tail, you know. You pick up a coin, you just don't get the heads, you get the tail also. So Krishna says, what is that? Dukkha yonaya evate. The so-called happiness giving things in this world are also the sources of misery. So one who understands this, he suddenly goes to antithesis. He starts saying, oh, everything is dangerous. You know, be careful. Ichha hi dukh ka mool karan hai. Ichhaon ko maar do. That kind of, he becomes very, you know, so that is antithesis. But they both have some major flaw. Karma ka advantage hai ki you can engage your senses because senses need real engagement. But uska disadvantage hai, it brings bondage. That disadvantage, which you don't want. And jnana ka advantage kya hai? No bondage. If you continue cultivating jnana and don't perform action in this world, no bondage, because every action is equal but opposite reaction. But the problem with jnana is it is unnatural. You cannot restrain your senses artificially without any higher engagement to them. Just like Vishwamitra Muni did for 60,000 years. It is same path. But then Rambha, Menaka, they came, you know, tinkling their ankle bells, all tapasya gone. Why? Because there is no higher engagement for the senses. So it is no bondage, but is not very natural for the soul, because by nature soul is active. Soul is not a dead, insentient this thing. Soul needs action. Bacche ko dekho, my God, they are so active. You wonder sometimes, are iska kuch karo re. You know? We have no capacity to engage them. You know, in this material body that poses so many limitations, we are so active. Think about it. So I'll just complete. So what is bhakti? It is an interesting thing. It completely keeps your senses engaged and it gives no bondage. It combines the advantages of these two and eliminates the disadvantage. That is why it is called synthesis. I hope this much philosophy is okay. Huh? In life. So bhakti, rushikena rushikesha sevanam bhakti ruchyate. Rushika means senses. Rushikesha means master of senses. Engaging our senses in the service of the Lord is called bhakti. And when you do that, when the senses are engaged under superior direction, when you act in this world, you don't get a reaction. It's just like an Indian soldier goes and kills so many people on the battlefield. He's not hanged for killing people. He's given, you know, Paramvir Chakra, you know, whatever. Why? Because it's an authorized action. It bears no reaction. So that is bhakti yoga. So Arjuna is being told to do this. Fight and you will not accrue any bondage, because it's a dharma yuddha. I think we should end here, because otherwise prasadam will get late. I'll continue question answers while you bring your plates together and we sit down and have it together. Thank you all very much. Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki jai. Srila Prabhupada ki jai.